تفتض به يعني تحك جلدها فإنه يموت من يعني مما على على جسمها. ولكن انظروا إلى العدة في الإسلام، فعدة المرأة المطلقة هذه العدة التي الأصل فيها بقاؤها في بيت زوجها، لأنه حماية لعرضها حتى تكون أقرب لرجوعها إذا كانت عدة يعني العدة الرجعية. وإذا كانت يعني وجعل الله مدة، انتبهوا يا إخوة، جعل الله مدة لمن يعني عدتها، لمن كان طلاقها رجعيا، جعل الله مدة 3 حيض، كل ذلك حتى يعني ترجع. ولم يكن حيضة واحدة مثل الخلع، فإن الخلع لأنها أرادت أن تخرج من عصمته، فمن حكمة الشارع الحكيم أنه جعل لها حيضة واحدة وهي استبراء الرحم، ولكن لما كان طلاقا جعل لها عدة المطلقة حتى لعلها أن تعود. وهذه من الحكم العظيمة التي أيضا كلها حماية للعرض، وحتى لا يكون يعني هدم للأسرة وهدم للحياة الزوجية، لأن الحياة الزوجية فيها عهد وميثاق، فيها عهد وميثاق عظيم. وأخذتم منهم وأخذنا منكم ميثاقا غليظا، أخذنا منكم ميثاقا غليظا. ولذلك كان السلف إذا جاء لي الكلام عن الطلاق أو على يعني على هذه قال إنه لميثاق غليظ، يذكر المرأة بذلك، يذكر الرجل على أن. ولذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إن أحق الشروط وفاء ما استحللتم به الفروج. هذا أمر عظيم عند الله عز وجل، وإنكم استحللتم فروجهن بكلمة الله. وقيل ما معنى كلمة الله؟ يعني بحكم الله الذي أباح لك ذلك، وهو الإيجاب والقبول. زوجتك ابنتي، قال قبلت، هذا هو كلمة الله، يعني حكم الله الذي جعل الزواج شرعيا. فكل هذا حماية للعرض، فهناك ضوابط وهناك أصول كلها جاءت لحماية العرض من الفساد والإفساد. نعم.
Also from the protection of honors is that which came that it is impermissible for one to cause her to cause a woman to start disliking her husband, as the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Furthermore, there is that one who does so, he is cursed, as the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "May Allah curse the one who causes a woman to dislike her husband." And also that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us, reminds us of trying to rectify between husband and wife if there is a conflict between them, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He legislated that there comes a representative from her family and from his family, and if they want, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if they want to rectify, Allah will bring them together. And all of that is from the protection of honors. And from the protection of honors in Islam is that it is impermissible for women to travel without a male guardian. And this is from the protection of the women, not imprisonment of the women or that they are not free, as some people say. Rather, this is from the protection of the women, that they do not travel without a male guardian, without a close male relative of theirs. And that is from their protection. And the male relative in this case has to be someone who has reached the age of puberty. And this is, it is not permissible for women to travel with other women without a male relative. That is not correct. And rather, women can be with other women.
ولو كان للحج بيت الله، كما جاء في الحديث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يعني للرجل الذي اكتتب في الجهاد، قال يا رسول الله إن زوجتي خرجت حاجة وإني اكتتبت في الجهاد، قال اذهب وحج مع امرأتك. نعم، ترك الجهاد في سبيل الله لأجل الذهاب مع زوجته. فلا يجوز ولو كان سفر الطاعة فكيف بالسفر المباح؟ وما سأله النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هل معها رفقة؟ هل هي مع رفقة مأمونة؟ أين؟ وعدم سؤال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذلك دليل على أنه يجب المحرم وأن الرفقة من قال بها أنها ليست صحيحة وليست محرم لا تكون محرما وليست محرما الرفقة ولو كانت صالحة فهم من أصلح الناس في ذلك الزمان مع ذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما جعله يترك زوجته تسافر يعني إما مع رفقة وإما لوحدها وهم من أصلح الناس ومن خير الناس.
That is even if she was traveling to go and perform Hajj. She's not allowed to travel by herself or even with good companions or people who are good to travel with her unless she has a close male relative. A man asked the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said to him that I was assigned to go and fight for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my wife, she went to perform Hajj and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam he commanded him to leave the army and going to fight for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and go perform Hajj with his wife. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not ask him, for example, did she go with people who would keep her safe, who would take care of her? No, this was not the case. Although the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam are the best of people. They are the best of people, may Allah be pleased with them. But yet the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not approve of her going to perform Hajj by herself. So if this was a travel of worship, to go and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how about traveling for permissible matters? There's no doubt that it is not permissible. And even if she was with women, with other women, that she knows that is not allowed. She cannot travel without a male relative. And this is unlike having other women to prevent her being alone with another man. Or with a man who is not a close relative of hers. That is a different matter. Meaning that if she was, a woman is not allowed, a man and a woman are not allowed to be alone in a private setting unless they are husband and wife or close relatives. However, if she has another woman with her, that is sufficient. That is permissible. This is different than her male guardian in regards to travel. And likewise, even if she has a young son who is old enough to know right from wrong, a young child who is not old enough to know right from wrong, a mature child, that is okay for her to be, if he is with her, that there is a man with them who is not a relative of hers. That is a different matter. Whereas when it comes to traveling, she has to have a male relative who has reached the age of puberty, who has hit puberty. And Islam honors the women, gives them special honor. In the pre-Islamic era of ignorance, the women used to be considered a dishonor. As was mentioned before in the previous classes, that they used to be buried alive because they are considered dishonored or a form of dishonor. And they used to be inherited, meaning that people inherit the women that you give. If one dies, and he has relatives, they take his wife, for example, as part of his inheritance. Whereas, and she would not be given anything in inheritance. If her relative dies, she is not given anything in inheritance. And she used to be sold. The woman used to be sold in the pre-Islamic era of ignorance. And Islam came to disallow all of that. And that she inherits from her relatives, and she is not a subject that is inherited. So Islam came to honor the women. And look at the waiting period that the women had in the pre-Islamic era of ignorance. If her husband dies, then she has to wait for an entire year. That she's not allowed to get married. Not only that, she's not allowed. She is commanded and she is forced to remain in a specific place where she's not allowed to leave. She's not allowed to take a bath for an entire year. So much so that they used to say if she grabs something to scratch her body with, it would die. And this is how bad it was. In Islam, it came to perfect these things. The waiting period of a woman, if her husband divorces her, with a divorce that within the time that she's allowed to return to him, to return to her husband, then she waits 3 periods, and she waits and she awaits in the house of her husband. Perhaps he would return her. Perhaps they would come back together. This is the reason for it. And it is a long time, and it is within the house of her husband, so that they would return to each other. Whereas if she did khula, meaning she asked for her own divorce and gave something in return for her divorce, then she only waits for 1 period just to clear that she's not pregnant, just to make sure that she is not pregnant from her husband. And all of that is from the perfection of Islam. And all of that is from the great wisdom and from the protection of the religion of Islam to the honors. Because in the marriage and the matters of marriage, we should know that it is a great and an important pledge and an important covenant that they have given to one another, the husband and the wife. It is a great and an important covenant that they have given to one another. Some of the Salaf, they used to say, that it is a great covenant, and pay attention to it. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, from the greatest of conditions that one puts in a contract is that which by which you make it permissible to have a relationship with a woman. And likewise, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, it became permissible for you to have a relationship with them, with the command of Allah, with the permission of Allah. Meaning the statements of I give you so and so in marriage and I accept her in marriage. This is a great covenant, and this is something that needs to be fulfilled and paid attention to. And for this reason, we find that there are many conditions and many principles that Islam came to protect the honors. All of those came in the religion of Islam, in the legislation of Islam, in protection of the honors.
ومن ذلك أيضا من حفظ الأعراض في الإسلام عدم مصافحة النساء التي لا تحل لك. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا أصافح النساء. وقالت عائشة رضي الله عنها ما مست يد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يد امرأة لا تحل له، وإنما كان يبايع النساء بالكلام.
Also from the protection of honors in Islam is that it is not permissible for men and women to shake their hands unless they are unless it is permissible. They are close relatives or they are husband and wife. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I do not shake the hands of women. Again, with that.
والله أنا أقول أفضل عفوا من close relative هذه، لأنه هذا قد يقصد به أيضا ابن العم، هذا يعتبر، لكن أن يقال المحرم المحرم أن يذكر كلمة أن يكون حراما يعني عليها، ما أدري إيش الكلمة الجيدة اللي تستخدم.
Is there a better translation than close relative?
أن close relative هذا أيضا الكزن. No. يقال close relative. هل هذا يجوز؟ ما يجوز. فالأفضل يعني أنك يعني ولذلك يا أخو الترجمة هذه تحتاج إلى انتباه، لأن الآن الناس عندما يسمعون هناك من يصافح بنت عمه وابن عمه وبنت خاله، هذا قد يفهمون مثل هذه الأشياء الخاطئة. فما هي الكلمة يعني، المهم نحن نتركها الآن، لكن ابحثوا عنها وابحثوا عن كلمة تكون يعني مفيدة للناس الأجيال بعدنا، وأيضا حتى يفهمونها فهم صحيح. نعم جزاك الله خير.
جزاك الله خير شيخنا.
نعم
قالوا هنا في هذا السنة.
So the word that I'm using, close relative, Shaykh Abdurrahman is pointing out that it is incorrect to use the word close relative in this case.
المعنى الصحيح.
It is not the correct translation.
And استطعت تقول forbidden يعني relative.
نعم.
هو قال أنا prohibited to marry.
نعم. هي تحتاج إلى ترجمة يعني جملة لأجل نعرف.
And this is something from that we find in the يعني.
يعني أظن لو استخدمنا هذه الكلمة forbidden relative يعني تكون أقرب. حتى تعطي انتباه.
ها؟ unmarriageable kin. جزاكم الله خير. This is
نعم. طيب.
unmarriageable kin. جزاكم الله خير.
الله.
So all of the instances where I said close relative, please change that to unmarriageable kin. Meaning that we should understand that it is not a close relative. Our Shaykh Abdullah, he said that some people, they go and shake the hands of cousins from their, between males and females, their female cousins. That is not permissible. And when we say close relative, when I said close relatives, this is an incorrect translation. Unmarriageable, yani kin, this is closer. Meaning that she is yani from the women whom one is not allowed to marry in Islam. And so in general, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not shake the hands of any unmarriageable kin. And likewise, Aisha radiallahu anha, she said the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam never touched the hand of a woman who is not permissible for him. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to take the pledge from the women, it was verbal. He never shook their hands.
ورواية أنه كان يدخل صلى الله عليه وسلم يده في الماء وتدخل هي يدها في الماء هذه لا تصح هذه رواية باطلة وهذه للأسف أنها منتشرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يبايع النساء في الماء وهذا لا يصح.
There are claims that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم or narrations that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم used to immerse his hands in water and then the women would immerse their hands in the water and give them the pledge of by way of doing that. There's nothing authentic from that. And this is there's nothing authentic of such narration.
أيضا من حماية الإسلام للأعراض من حماية الإسلام للأعراض وجوب الحجاب على المرأة وأن الحجاب جاء لصيانتها وللحفاظ عليها. ولذلك قال سبحانه وتعالى يا أيها النبي قل لأزواجك وبناتك ونساء المؤمنين يدنين عليهن من جلابيبهن ذلك أدنى أن يعرفن فلا يؤذين. يعني يعرفن بماذا؟ يعرفن بالحشمة، يعرفن بالتقوى، يعرفن بالصيانة، يعرفن بالمحافظة فلا يؤذين. لأن الذي تؤذى هي التي تبدي وهي التي تضرب بخلخالها لأسمع الرجال صوت ما تخفي من زينتها إلى غير ذلك. فإذا الحجاب أيضا من الأمور العظيمة التي حفظ الله عز وجل به الأعراض.
Also from the protection of honors in Islam is that it is obligatory upon the women to cover themselves. And that came as a protection for the women and for the honors. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the meaning of the verse, our Prophet, say to your wives and your daughters and the women of the believers that they should cover themselves with their jalabib, with their outer garments. This is better that they are known so they will not be harmed. This is better that they will be known as believing women, as women who are chaste, as women who are away from sins and disobedience, so that they would not be harmed.
ومن ذلك أيضا تحريم الفواحش من ذلك فاحشة الزنا ومقدمات هذه الفاحشة مما ذكرنا من النظر ومن الخلوة ومن لين الكلام. وجاء الإسلام بأننا إذا سألتموهن فاسألوهن من وراء حجاب. وما جاء في أن هذه الفاحشة فاحشة الزنا أنها مفسدة للنسب ومفسدة كذلك للأسر والأخلاق وأنها جريمة عظيمة. كل ذلك للحفاظ على العرض. حفاظ العرض في الإسلام جاء للمحافظة على العرض. والكلام في هذا الباب يعني عظيم وكثير. وأكتفي بما ذكرنا وننتقل إلى ما يتعلق بالمال لنذكر إلماحة فيه.
Also from the protection of honors in Islam is the prohibition of sins and the shameful acts of sin such as adultery, and not only adultery itself but also all of the things that lead to adultery, from impermissible looking and from being in a separate sitting between a man and a woman who are alone by themselves, and likewise the soft speech between the a man and a husband whom it is not permissible, and also as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded, and if you ask them for a matter, then ask them from behind the veil. And this is purer and better for your hearts and their hearts. And there's no doubt that the adultery and is a destroyer. It destroys the families and the lineage, and it destroys the honors. And this is, of course, the topic of honors and their protection. Islam is a lengthy topic, but this is in brief. And inshallah, our Shaykh Abdurrahman said we will also talk about wealth and the protection of wealth in brief as well, bi-idhnillah ta'ala.
من الضروريات الخمس أيضا المال وهي الضرورة الخامسة وقد جاء في الشرع ما يدل على فضل المال أولا يعني أن في شرعنا بيان أن للمال فضلا وأنه نعمة من نعم الله عز وجل وكما قال سبحانه وتعالى المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا ولذلك سئل الشيخ بن باز رحمه الله تعالى هل يجوز أن يقال بأن المال وسخ الدنيا قال لا يجوز بل هو زينة الحياة الدنيا.
From the five necessities that Islam came to protect is wealth. Islam came to show, and one of the same things that we find in the religion of Islam is that wealth is a bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a bounty and a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the meaning of the verse, wealth and children are the beauty of this life. And for this reason, some people say that wealth is, they say something that means wealth is the trash of this life or is the filth of this life. This statement, Shaykh Abdulaziz bin Baz rahimahullah, he said this is an incorrect statement and it should not be said.
والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال نعم المال الصالح للمرء الصالح. نعم المال الصالح للرجل الصالح أو للمرء الصالح.
The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, what an excellent thing is good wealth for a good man.
وقد حث الإسلام على طلب الرزق. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اليد العليا خير من اليد السفلى. وقال لذاك الرجل اذهب واحتطب. فحث الإسلام على الرزق وعلى طلب الرزق فامشوا في مناكبها وكلوا من رزقه. نعم.
We find in the religion of Islam that we are encouraged to seek the provision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Such as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the upper hand is better than the lower hand.
And the Messenger... والعليا هي المعطية والسفلى هي الآخذة.
The upper hand is the one that gives. And the lower hand is the one that receives. So the upper hand is the better hand, the one that gives. And Islam encourages us to seek the provision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commanded the man to go and collect some firewood or some wood. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the meaning of the verse, and spread out in the land and seek the provision of Allah.
وقال كذلك سبحانه وتعالى فإذا قضيت الصلاة المقصود بها صلاة الجمعة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله. فأمرنا الله عز وجل بأن نبتغي من فضل الله والمقصود بفضل الله هنا الرزق.
This is the same. I translated the wrong ayat. So if the salah ends, then spread out in the land and seek the provision of Allah.
وكذلك قال لسعد بن أبي وقاص رضي الله عنه لما أراد أن يعطي ماله كله لله عز وجل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما قبل منه وقال يعني ورد عليه ذلك ثم قال الشطر يا رسول الله والنصف قال لا قال الثلث قال والثلث كثير ثم بين له أمرا عظيما قال لئن تترك أو لئن تدع ورثتك أغنياء خير من أن تدعهم عالة يتكففون الناس فإذا الإسلام حث على أيضا أن تترك ورثتك أغنياء وقد سئل شيخ الإسلام تيمية أيهما أفضل الغني الشاكر أم الفقير الصابر قال أتقاهما لله إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم فالإنسان لا يذم على الغنى ولا يمدح على الفقر، وإنما يمدح بالتقوى. ولذلك جاء من أشر الناس، أو جاء من الذين لا ينظر الله إليهم ولا يزكيهم ولهم عذاب أليم، من هم؟ منهم الفقير العائل المستكبر. العائل المستكبر يعني فقير ومستكبر. فالفقير قد يكون مستكبرا أكثر من الغني. نعم.
The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, when Sa'd رضي الله عنه, he wanted to give all of his wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did not accept from him. And then he said half of it, and the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said no. He said the third, and the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم he accepted and he approved of the third, and he said even the third is a lot. And then he.
ولذلك استحب العلماء أن الوصية تكون أقل من الثلث لقوله والثلث كثير. لكن لو أوصى بالثلث يعني تنفذ الوصية، ولكن الأولى أن الإنسان إذا أوصى يوصي بأقل من الثلث.
For this reason, the people of knowledge they say that in one's last will, it is better to give less than the third in charity. And they say if one has the third in his last will testimony, then that is accepted. It is accepted and it is acted upon or enacted. However, what is better is to give less than the third, because of the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the third, and the third is a lot. And then the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our Shaykh Abdullah, he said he clarified a very important matter. And he said to him, it is that you leave those who will inherit from you rich and wealthy. It is better for them, or it is better for you, than that you leave them in need asking the people. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he was asked, who is better? A wealthy person who is thankful and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or a poor person who is patient? And he rahimahullah, he said, the one who is more pious is better. So we should understand that being wealthy by itself, being wealthy is not something that is blameworthy. Nor is being poor something that is praiseworthy. For this we find in the hadith that from the people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not look at them, meaning of a look of honor and mercy, in giving them mercy, and will not speak to them, and to them is a severe torment. One of them is one who is poor but has arrogance and boasting off.
وقد جاء عن عبد الرحمن بن عوف رضي الله عنه وكان من أغنياء الصحابة قال يا حبذا المال يا حبذا المال أصل منه رحمي وأتقرب إلى ربي عز وجل.
عبد الرحمن بن عوف رضي الله عنه, who was very wealthy, he was one of the wealthier companions, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, what an excellent thing is wealth. I connect with my kins and I seek nearness to my Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala.
كذلك لذلك يا إخوة ألف العلماء في فضل التجارة ككتاب ابن الخلال رحمه الله تعالى, وألف أيضا ابن أبي الدنيا كتابا سماه إصلاح المال. فالسلف كان لهم عناية في بيان فضل المال, بل إن الصحابة رضي الله عنهم استخدموا المال استخداما عظيما في نصرة الإسلام. فقال الصحابة الفقراء قالوا ذهب أهل الدثور بالأجور, ذهب أهل الدثور يعني أهل الأموال بالأجور. فالمال لا يذم لذاته, بل هو سبيل إلى 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 الخير, تجعله أنت سبيلا للخير. جاء عن سفيان الثوري أنه قال المال اليوم سلاح المؤمن, المال اليوم سلاح المؤمن. هذا رواه ابن أبي الدنيا في كتابه إصلاح المال.
For this reason, we find that some of the people of knowledge, they authored books regarding the virtues of trading and the wealth, such as the book of Al-Khalal. He has a book